Okay, good morning everyone. So we're gonna continue chapter 3, lesson 8b. It's about application of sine and cosine derivative. Yeah, so this is the continuity of the previous lesson. So you can open your book, page 109. Okay. So basically for the sine and cosine function itself, I know that you have learned it in 11th grade, but maybe you forget. So I'll review about it a little bit, yeah. So the general equation of sine and cosine function is written as y equals a plus b sine or cosine c x minus d. Okay, so this is the general function of sine or cosine, general equation of a sine or cosine function, where the a is actually refers to vertical translation. Okay, and this will reflect to the properties of the graph. It will reflect the position of the sinusoidal axis. Okay, remember? And then for the B, actually it represents, it shows the vertical dilation. Vertical dilation of the function. And then on the graph, it shows the amplitude. It shows the amplitude of the sinusoidal function, okay? And then for C, it represents the horizontal dilation, which is the reciprocal of it. And on the graph, it shows the period of your sinusoidal function. Okay, and the last for the D, it shows a horizontal translation. Horizontal translation, and on the graph, it shows the phase displacement of the graph. Yeah, so I will also review for the graph. So let's say that you have this x and y, and you have a basic, let's say, so this is 2 pi and pi. Or let's not do this. Oh yeah, and then let's not give the this one. So let's say, and then I have a sinusoidal function. For example, this is the sinusoidal axis. And this is the lower bound. And this is the upper bound. Okay. So the sinusoidal axis is determined by the A. And then the upper bound and the lower bound is actually depends on the period, right? This is not a period, the amplitude. So the value of the B will determine the position of the upper bound and the lower bound. Okay. And then let's say that I started from here, and then it's a sine like this, let's say. Okay, so the value of x from this point to this point, this is the period. So the period is basically how long or what value of x is needed to repeat a cycle of a sinusoidal graph. Okay, and if we are using sine, then this is the phase displacement. This is the phase displacement. Okay? So that's the review. I hope you remember about it. And then now we are getting into the application of its derivative. So basically it's still related with the previous lesson, which is displacement, velocity, and acceleration. Okay, so if you have a displacement function, then if you derive it, it becomes a velocity. If you derive a velocity, then it becomes the acceleration. So basically, acceleration is the second derivative of displacement. So let's get into the example right away, so you have more idea about what is the application of the sine and cosine function derivative. Example 1, page 110. A mass is bouncing up and down on a spring hanging from the ceiling. Look at the figure. Its distance, y, so y is a displacement function, in feet from the ceiling, varies sinusoidally with time. So this is a period a periodic function, t in seconds, making a complete cycles every 1.6 seconds. At t equals 0.4, y reaches its greatest value, 8 feet. The smallest y gets in 2 feet. So let's examine the information given here. We know that the function is sinusoidally, it's varies sinusoidally with time, and then it makes a complete cycle every 1.6 seconds. So it means that the period is 1.6 seconds. Okay? And then at t equals 0.4, y reaches its greatest value. It reaches the greatest value, it means it reached the upper bound. So the phase displacement, in this case, the phase displacement is 0.4 seconds if we use cosine function, because cosine starts in a upper bound, right? Because cosine starts in the upper bound, so the phase displacement, it reached the greatest value. And the greatest value is 8, so the upper bound is 8, and the lower bound is 2. From this one, we can conclude that the sinusoidal axis is in between upper bound and lower bound, which is 8 plus 2 divided by 2, which is 5. And with this information, we also can conclude that the amplitude is actually equal to 3, because the distance between the sinusoidal axis and the upper bound, the distance between the sinusoidal axis and the lower bound is equal to 3. Now that we have all the information, we should be able to determine the particular equation of the trigonometric function. Or basically, this is a circular function because it's not in degree. So before that, because the period is 1.6 seconds, we need to be able to determine the horizontal displacement first. In this case, the horizontal displacement is equal to the new period over the original period. So it's basically 1.6 divided by 2 pi, because this is a cosine. So 0.8. So basically the horizontal displacement, it's actually 4 over 5 pi. Okay? So now we have all the informations. So the y will be equal to a is the sinusoidal axis, plus b is the amplitude, we use cosine. Reciprocal of the horizontal display dilation is 5 pi over 4. And then in parenthesis, x over t, because it's time, t minus 0.4 second. So this is the displacement function, which is asked for the question A, right? An equation of for y in term of t. So this is already y in term of t. Okay. And then the next question is write an equation for the derivative y prime. So we derive it y prime, 5 derived becomes 0, and then 3 cosine. So 3 is the coefficient, so 3 will still be there. And then the derivative of cosine is negative sine, so times negative sine, whatever inside it, 5 pi over 4, t minus 0.4. And then don't forget to multiply it with the derivative of the inside function. So the next inside function is actually this one. So the derivative of the inside function is actually 5 pi over 4. Okay? 5 pi over 4. So if we simplify, then the result is actually equal to negative 15 pi over 4 sine 5 pi over 4. T minus 0.4. So this is the derivative of displacement, which is actually also we can name it as the velocity of the object. Okay. How fast is the mass moving for this values of T? So basically you just need to substitute when t equals 1. You can just see, I'll take the answer from the book, which is negative 8.3. When t equals to 1.5, the phi equals 10.9. Sorry, this is 10.9. Okay. And when the t equals 2.7, the phi is equal negative 4.5. So basically, you just need to substitute the value of t to the equation of phi. Yeah. And then the next question. At t equals 2.7 second, is the mass moving up or down? Justify your answer. Okay. Now look, when the t is equal to 0.7, when the t is equal to 2.7, the phi is negative, right? Because the derivative is negative, so we can conclude that actually the value of y is decreasing in this moment. The value of y is decreasing in that moment. And if we see actually y is the distance between the ceiling and the object and the mass, right? So if the distance is decreasing, the mass is actually going up at this moment. Okay, the mass is going up at the moment. Okay, and then the last question is what is the fastest the mass moves? So because this is the phi, it asks for what's the fastest the mass moves, then the velocity, of course, because the maximum value of sine is 1, right? Or negative 1. In this case, because it's asking about the speed, the fastest, so we don't care about the negative sign and the positive sign because it's only represent the direction. So we can ignore the negative. So basically, the fastest, the phi max, I put the absolute value to determine that it's actually the magnitude instead of the factor, only taking the magnitude, is actually 15 pi over 4. Yeah, 15 pi over 4, because the maximum value of sine is 1. And then where is the mass when it's moving this fast? So basically, we need to find the t first to do that. So 15 pi over 4 is equal to negative 15 pi over 4 sine 5 pi over 4 t minus 0.4. Okay, so cancel. So basically, and then we can also ignore the negative, like I said, because we are talking about the fastest. So basically, we need to find the value that makes sine 5 pi over 4 t minus 0.4 is equal to 1. So if we sine inverse, then 5 pi over 4 t minus 0.4 is equal to sine inverse 1 is 90 degrees, which is half pi. Okay, then cancel the pi, cancel this one. So we have 2. So we have 5 over 2 t minus 0.4 is equal to 1. So t minus 0.4 is equal to 1 minus 0. I'm sorry, 2 over 5. So t is equal to 0.4 plus 0.4, which is 0.8 seconds. Okay, so that's the application of that's the example of the application of the sine on cosine derivative. So yeah, that's all for today. Thank you.